attention, please. You will have seen the signs on the doors to say that we are webcasting the meeting this evening. If anybody does come up to speak and does want to be filmed, if you could just indicate to me when you sit at the petitioner's or the applicant's chair here, just indicate to me that you don't want to be filmed and we'll sort that out, okay? Welcome to the Planning Committee. My name is Councillor Anita Leech and I'm the Chair of the Committee. My role this evening is to ensure that the Committee runs smoothly having regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. And can I just ask if anybody does have a mobile phone with them, they have it turned off or on silent, please. To explain who the rest of the people on the tables here tonight are, to my immediate left is the Council, Council's Solicitor, who will give advice to the committee on any procedural or legal matters that might arise. To my left are the council's planning officers, highway engineer and environmental health officer, who will present the application this evening and give any technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people who you see down both sides of the tables are the elected members who will consider the applications this evening and make the decisions. Before each application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officers. In the event that an application has received a qualifying petition signed by 25 signatures or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be advised to make representations to the committee in support of their application, again for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. A ward councillor can address the committee in relation to an application. The ward councillor may speak on behalf of the residents. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they may not return to take part in any debate that may follow by the committee. The applications will then be open to debate and discussion by members of the planning committee, who will then make a decision on the application. Tonight we have quite a number of people here for agenda item 6, which is the former Kershaw House. So I'm going to put to committee that we actually take that as the first application. Is that okay with committee?
Yeah.
If a site visit is requested and approved this evening, then this matter will not be discussed any further this evening.
Can I just make a point? Mr. Norbury, councillor, has just arrived to make representations on behalf of the residents for that one. I believe he's put it back into the order.
Okay, we do have to go through a couple of items beforehand, but if he's not here, then I'll hold that. Thank you for pointing that out. Okay, members, the minutes are on pages 1 to 16. Can I have your approval for those minutes, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Visiting the site to see what looks to me to be an overdevelopment of the site.
Thank you. David?
Yeah, thank you, Chair. I'd like to move for a site visit on agenda item 8, which is in Wallasey Village. Just by brief way of background, in 2015 we turned down an application for one property on the particular site. The members of the committee then are not the ones who are here now. This application involves two dwellings on the same site, and we feel it's totally necessary to have a site visit to see the implications of that new.
Thank you, David. So we've had requests for 4 site visits. If I read those out, and then I'll ask the magistrate to approve that, please. Agenda item 5, which is 16 Brimstage Road, Barnston. Agenda item 6, former Pershaw House School, Plainfields, Glenavon. Agenda item 7, 2 Don Avenue, Spittle. And agenda item 8, vacant land to the rear of 240, 240B, Wallasey Village, Wirral. Can I have your approval for this, please?
Yes, please.
Okay. For the members of the public who are here for those particular items, as I said in my opening, Gavin, we won't be discussing those any further this evening. I think it's important if the committee are saying they feel it's important to have those site visits, then it gives us a better idea of exactly what it is that we're going to either be approving or refusing. So please bear with us with your patience, because I know we've dragged you here this evening, and what we won't be discussing this evening will be at the next planning committee, which will be next month, and our site visits will be the Tuesday before the planning committee. If I can just check the date of that. It would be the 13th of September that we have the site visits. So if people do want to leave now, then we will give you a couple of minutes to just make that move. Thank you.
Okay, so the planning permission is sought for the demolition of existing kennels, cattery, indoor riding school and other associated buildings, and the redevelopment of the site with 8 detached dwellings together with associated infrastructure and landscaping. The site is located in the Greenbelt, and as such the proposed redevelopment of the site with residential properties is a departure from the development plan. Therefore, the main issues relating to this proposal is whether or not the development would constitute inappropriate development in the Greenbelt and the effect of the development on the character and appearance of the area. Considering the first issue and whether the development proposed constitutes inappropriate development, Policy GB2 of the Unitary Development Plan, which deals with the developments in the Greenbelt, and the National Planning Policy Framework are the principal policy considerations to be taken into. Policy GB2 states that new buildings in Greenbelt will be considered an appropriate development unless it falls within specified categories which are set out under the policy context in your rules on page 21. The recently revised National Planning Policy Framework, reissued on the 24th of July this year, also sets out that construction of new buildings in Greenbelt should be regarded as inappropriate development, but again specifies a number of exemptions, including the limited infilling or the partial or complete redevelopment of previously developed land, whether redundant or in continued use. The framework defines previously developed land as that which is or was occupied by permanent structures, including the curtilage of the developed land. The framework also states that it should not be assumed that the whole of that curtilage should be developed. The proposals seek to demolish a number of buildings across the site, 9 in total, including the kennels, cattery and indoor riding school, and to redevelop the site with 8 dwellings laid out in a rough horseshoe arrangement. The proposals will see a reduction of built development across the site by way of a reduced footprint from 1,486 square metres at present to 990 square metres as proposed. This equates to a reduction in footprint of 33%. Although the development proposed introduces two-storey dwellings to the site, there are a number of large buildings present, notably the indoor riding school. Notwithstanding the additional floor space above ground floor level that is proposed, there will still result a reduction of volume across the site from 8,004 cubic metres to 6,470 cubic metres. This equates to a reduction in volume by 19%. Railway Road has the character of a rural lane that is interspersed with dwellings and open spaces. The scheme has been amended to set back the first of the proposed dwellings by some 20 metres from the edge of Railway Road. This will retain the open space between Woodville and Dale Cottage. The boundary hedgerow will be retained and the front of the site will be planted with a small orchard which will be maintained by agreement with the residents of the new dwellings. This is conditioned as part of the proposed landscaping condition that has been updated on the lay list. The new dwellings have been sensitively designed using palleted materials that are appropriate to the semi-wall setting of the site. The site is visually contained and additional landscaping proposed will further mitigate any potential harm to the openness of the area. The development achieves separation and interface distances comfortably, both in terms of the relationship between the new dwellings and existing dwellings abutting the site, and also between the new dwellings themselves. The development would remove a number of unattractive, large, bulky buildings from the site, and would also remove the kennels and cattery, which have been the subject of complaints locally, that have resulted in the service and enforcement of abatement notices. The removal of these uses will have the benefit of removing a development that has caused a nuisance by way of noise and disturbance in the area. Whilst the absence of a 5-year housing land supply does not mean that new housing development should be allowed anywhere, nevertheless, this development will contribute towards the council's housing land supply. In summary, the proposed development represents the redevelopment of previously developed land, and therefore it is not considered that the proposals constitute inappropriate development in Greenbelt, having regards to principles and definitions set out in the updated National Planning Policy Framework. The dwellings have been sensitively designed in respect to harmonise with the existing character and appearance of the area, and working in keeping with both the local context and distinctiveness of the locality. It is not considered that the development would have any materially greater harmful impact on Greenbelt when assessed against the footprint and volume of the buildings presently on site, and in fact would result in a reduction of built form across the site as a whole. The development does not conflict with the Green Belt Protection Aims of the National Planning Policy Framework and is recommended for approval. There is no petition in association with this application.
Thank you, Matthew. The gentleman at the back in the blue suit, I noticed you just walked in. And we have deferred and got site visits on a number of items. Can you just tell me which item you're here for?
This one.
I'm here for this one, that's fine. Okay. Good timing. Okay. Is there a board councillor to speak on this? No? Okay, can I open this up to debate with the committee?
please. David?
Yeah, just very briefly, Chair, we've had a number of situations like this in the past where an area which has been ostensibly green belt has had existing buildings on it, and because of that, we've taken it as being effectively a brownfield site. And the work that we do to try and build something on there is going to improve upon what is already there. Without going back into too far into history, the Warrens with such an application some years ago that I was deeply involved in. I think my conclusion to this would be I'm not in favour of building in Greenbelt in principle. I'd like that to go on record. I think it's already on record, both locally and in the local media. But there are situations where we have to use our brains, we have to try and make a particular development that has lost its way turn into something more productive and more useful and more beneficial to the community as a whole. So my view would be that there would be no greater material harm to the Green Belt by proceeding with this development as was already there. So I am minded to think that despite my general views on the Green Belt, this is one of those situations where you have to use a bit of common sense, a bit of brain power and allow something to go ahead. That clearly is going to be an advantage to the area and help to meet our housing requirements. That's really all I wanted to say, Chair. Thank you.
Are there any other comments? Adrian?
Yes, sorry. I'm going to make this thing work. How is this working? Yes, I find myself in a reasonably unusual situation with green, before I even say. But what strikes me about this is although it's in the sense green belt, it's not as though it's arable land, and it's not as though it's ancient woodland, and it has been used already for a purpose which is not going to be significantly, dramatically different, and if anything, I think it would be beneficial, so I'm always going to put it in the sense.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Pat? Yeah, thanks, Chair. Just a question really about the amended condition, condition 5. We've added 0.5. Condition 5. Just wants a bit of clarification about how that would actually work. In fact, this refers to the community orchard. I think that's where we're going. There's a community orchard on the border of the site where it meets the main road. And I'm just kind of struggling to understand myself how this condition would actually work in practice, what the actual point of the amended condition is. If you could just get clarification on that, please.
Thank you to you, Chair. It's not a community orchard in the sense that it's open to the whole community. It's a landscaping buffer that's going to be provided at the front of the site that will be managed by the residents that will live within the confines of the development. So essentially it will work in the same way as any public open space that you might find on a larger development. So residents would pay into a management scheme and that part of the site would be managed communally.
Mike, a big question?
Yeah, okay, thank you.
Okay. Any other points?
Thank you, Chair. Can I just place it on record that I don't think that this is going to fit in with the surrounding area? The houses will be new and will, to me, stand out like a sore thumb. applications for TPOs on trees, one in Sand Road in Bury Lake, and the second one, Hensley Road in Hensley. In relation to the Sandy Road application, an objection has been received against the TPO on the grounds that the tree is old and distorted, and there is a strong wind and chance that the tree could fall down and branches blow off. Now, the council's tree officers have inspected the tree and confirmed some no indication that the tree is in a dangerous condition, and therefore recommending that the TPO be applied to that tree. In relation to the second. In relation to the second application, objections have been received because the tree is too high and branches over and look over the hanging bridge gardens. However, the tree officers think that the TPO will allow proper maintenance for those trees, and they're not going to be cut too short and in the end die because of that. So it's recommended both TPOs are fine.
Thank you very much. So we'll take it on to item 9 first. Members, are there any comments? Are we happy to agree on?
Yes.
All those in favour? That's unanimous, Mr. Curry, thank you. Agenda item 10. Any comments? Are we happy to approve that? All those in favour?
Do we need a mover for that, Chair?
Sorry. I do apologise, members. It appears we do need a mover, so if we go back to 9, can I have a mover, please? David, and a seconder, Sam. All those in favour? Okay, I'm glad to vote the same way. Agenda item 10 then, can I have a mover, please? George, Matt. All those in favour? Well, that's unanimous, thank you, members. Okay, agenda item 11 is deferred, so we're now moving to agenda item 12, which is page 257 in your